Hello, welcome to the Excited Education channel, the YouTube channel, which brings you about mathematics and biology. Yeah, as usual, I'm Jamie Chris on the YouTube channel called Excited Education channel. I would like to invite each and everybody who is watching this video first to make subscribe, comment, share and like, such that he or she is ready to follow different videos that I would like to upload on this channel. Welcome to my module of today, where I am going to discuss about on biology and health science. So here we are going to discuss about STEM and what comprises STEM, what is the importance of STEM in the biology of level 1. So as usual, you know that we are talking about the structure of flowering plant. As you know, we are discussing about different parts of flowering plant, where we start from roots and you go to the leaves. Now we are going to discuss about the stem. So let us go ahead. The general characteristic of stem have different features that represent it to be like a stem. So a stem has leaves at irregular interval and terminal buds at growing point. The region of stem from which the leaf spring is called the node. So, and the length of stem between the node is called the internode. As you see here in this figure, this is what you call a stem with the leaves. Where the leaves likely to touch is what you call the point of node. So the length between a leaf and another leaf simply means the length between one node and another node is what you call the internode. So here, this is a node, and this length is what you call the internode. So this is what you call a stem. Yeah. Then commonly the stem is erect, but it may be horizontal as in runner. So underground as rhizomes, very short and never showing above ground as in bulbs and combs. Long, thin and weak as in climbing plants, or stout and thick as in trees. So here, this is one feature. Commonly, stems are in different forms. Even if this is bulbs, they have a certain stem. If it is rhizomes, they have a certain stem. If it is the climbing plants, they have another form of a stem. So stems are in different forms. So, young stems are usually green and contain chlorophyll. The cells in younger stems are living and obtain a supply of oxygen from the air through opening called stomata or rent cell in their epidermis. You have to know that in stem, some younger stem, they have green pigment, which is called chlorophyll. And the younger cells or the cells in younger stem are living and obtain a supply of oxygen. So the older stems supported by wood and fibrous tissue, which are added layer by layer, so increasing their thickness. If the stem is at an old age, it likely to be supported by wood. You know that stem, if it is in maturity stage, it looks like a wood. So there are different types of stem. First, herbaceous stem. They do not have developed ligninous structure and they are generally flat. So we find them in plants like the flowering. The herbaceous stem, they like to be found on annual plants, the plants with a year half time. These plants that are in higher forest, they like to be herbaceous stem because they like to live with a half time of a year. So there is what we call vivacious plant. Vivacious plants are plants with aerial stem. lasting a single season but keeping underground structures from which new stem springs again. So this is another type of stem where they likely to be as in single season but keeping underground structures. So even though they are not really living on upper part, but for their underground, they likely to be in living mode. So there is what we call Regenia system. For Regenia system, they have developed rigid, stiffened structure that we normally know as wood. According to the height they attain, we classify into two. So the Regenia stem directly to, if we say the Regenia stem, directly think about woods. So, and they can be classified according to the height, where we find there is trees, plant with Regenia stem, which a superior height of 5 meters. In this case, the stem are called trunks. They do not generally branch up to considerable soil. So there is what you call shrubs. These trees are real trees, like those on forest. Shrubs are the combination of different smaller plants. Let us see that are those plants with Regenia stem from 1 to 5 meters. In this case, branching begins at the soil level. They require to make branches since they're starting from its growth on the soil. So, special types of stem, they are some special types of stem. The most important are rhizomes. Rhizomes are stems that grow horizontally under the ground. From the roots are born, moving downwards into the ground, and other herbaceous system follows the opposite way, searching higher. So here, these are a special stem which is called rhizomes. So they like to grow underground. They don't like to move above the ground. And so apart from food, they are a way of plant propagation. These are what you call rhizomes. These are what you call rhizomes, and they like to be in underground. So these are likely to be found on those plants of pteridophytes. So ferns, yeah. And here there is what you call tubers. These are expanded stem by accumulation of food for the plant, such as potato or tulip bulbs. They have buds where new plants grow. So those were called tubers. Like to look about potatoes, like Irish potato or sweet potatoes. They have tubers. So, and also, you know, these are tubers. These are one structure of potatoes, and what we call the tubers is this one. Yes, with eyes, and they have leaves, shoots, sproteous tube. They have nodes, scale leaves, and rent cells. So this is a structure of tubers. There is what we call bulbs. These are adapted underground stems that store food provision. For instance, in onion, if you understand, or if you say the type of stem, special stem, which is called bulbs, just think about onions. This is one example, or a good example of a bulb. So this is what we call onion. To have scale leaves, made of scale leaves, and they have basal plate, the immature flower, and leaves directly to be found inside the of the bulb. So there's what you call succulent stems. These are aerial stems that stores water and other nutrient substances. So they become very fat because of water reservoir for the long dry period they have to start. So these succulents, they are also well adapted to the environment where they live. So here they have transformed into prinkles, which besides increasing water provision, so helps the plants to keep herbivores out of range. So this is what you call the succulent stem. You see, if you watch this plant, this sort of plant, you have to know that they have what you call succulent stem. So what you call succulent stem is this one. These are what you call succulent water. security system. So this is another special type of stem. Let us continue and see what you call above ground stem. These stems do not grow below the ground, as you know, above it is up on the ground. So they like to be found in upper ground, and they don't can be found in below the ground, but on the surface or the very near to it. The most important are sterons. So the sterons, these are weak spreading stems running the surface of the ground and producing new plants from nodes. For instance, strawberry, this is the structure of what we call sterons, and directly to have the weak spreading stems. So here, these are what you call weak spreading stem. This one, as you see, running is spreading, and there's what you call venoms. So the vines, these are stems that grow on the ground surface till they find something to get upright. So they are slender with the long internodes, for instance in beans. I think everybody have will see the structure of bean. The stem of bean, they like to be soft, and they are grown on the ground surface until they find something to get upright. For instance, those beans that are likely to be supported by smaller sticks, and they have to climb on that stick. So this that system of climbing stems, they like to be called vines, and the good example is what you call beans. So they can achieve their goals by means of climbing stem with elastic stem that winds around the other plants or structure. And functions of the stem, it supports the structure of the shoot. This is one example of the structure of the frangle plant, which is called this stem, and it supports the structure of the shoot. You know, the shoot is the upper part of the plant, and it spaces out the leaves so that they receive adapted air and sunlight. So due to the presence of the stem in the plants, they like to favor or to support the process of photosynthesis, because it gives or it spaces up the leaves in order to trap sunlight clearly and very easily. It allows conduction of water from soil to leaf and food from leaves to other parts of the plants. You know that they are what we call conductive tissues. Those conductive tissues are responsible for transporting this water and the mineral salts. The one which is responsible for transforming water is what we call xylem, and the one responsible for transforming food nutrients is what we call phloem. So stem is the one, or it's where those vascular tissues are likely to be found. So it holds flowers above ground, thus assisting pollination by insect or wind. So you know that stems, it holds the flowers. So in the presence of flowers on the stem, directly to be allowing those insects to make what you call pollination. If the stem is green, photosynthesis may occur in it. So even though we said that the photosynthesis is likely to be occurred on the leaves, but also the greenish or green pigment of the stem also can favor it to make photosynthesis. So let us see some evaluation exercise and try to make it and done it in order to evaluate yourself if you have heard what you have said in upper part. So name the general characteristic of the stem, give and explain any two types of stem, and discuss any two special types of stem. So and ends with giving the function of stem of a plant. So let us see what you call flower. This is one structure of flowering plants. So this is a part of the shoot specially modified or for reproduction. It is a reproductive structure of plants. First, the site of reproduction of plants occurred on the flowers. That's why we call it the reproductive structure of plants. So this one structure of flower, you see, there's what you call pollen grains. These are likely to be occurred or to be transformed from anthers to the stigma in the process of what you call pollination. So there is what you call anthers, filaments, petals, styles, pollen, tube, ovary, ovules, sepals, receptacles, and pedicels. So here, most flowers have both male and female reproductive organs, though some are of a single sex. So let us see floral parts and their function. You have to know that flowers have both male and female. If you say male and female, you can see this structure. This structure can call the female, and this structure can call be called what you call male. So let us continue floral parts and their functions. The floral parts are arranged in whorls or spirals with short internodes, often born at the end of the floral stalk pedicel, whose end is expanded to form a receptacle. So there are four kinds of floral leaves. Floral leaves, or what you call floral parts, so which are arranged in a ring or whorl. They are what you call the sepal for the calyx, the petal for the corolla, the stamen for the androecium, the carpels for the gynoecium, and or pistil. So this is what you call four kinds of floral parts. So they have different floral formulas, even though we try to discuss on it, but mostly five kinds of floral leaves, as is what you call the petal from the corolla, the stamen from the androecium, the carpels from the gynoecium or pistil, and the sepals from the calyx. And B, the petals and the sepals together form what you call perianth. So the correct word or the correction of petals and sepals is called what? Perianth. Perianth. And let us see what you call the calyx. We said the calyx is the sepals. So this consists of sepals and is the lower and the outermost whole of floral parts. Typically, the calyx protect the inner holes of the flower during bud stage. You know that calyx are those outer parts. So those outer parts we call the sepals, they are likely to cover up the inner part of the flower during the bud stage. And the sepals are usually green, but in some plants, e.g. Barbados bright, they are in the same color as the petals and are therefore described as petaloids. The reason why barbados are likely to be called petaloids is because they have the same color of like that of petals. So sepals may be free. Yeah, you have to know that sepals can be free, separate from one another, e.g. flowers of the Ipomia sp or fused. So whole or partial joined together, e.g. hibiscus. And B, any floral part outside the calyx is called the epicalyx. The floral part outside the calyx is what you call epicalyx. Let's see what you call the corolla. We find that the epicalyx or the calyx is the collection of sepals, whereas the corolla is the collection of what? Petals. So this is right inside the petal and is attached slightly higher on the receptacles. So the petals are often colored and scented. They have smell and they are colored. They attract insects with visit flowers and collect nectars and pollen. Pollination, pollinating the flower as they do so. So if it is colored, automatically it attracts insects. And due to visited by the insects, it can also collect nectars and pollen. Small grooves or dark as line in the petal called horn guides are thought to direct the insect to the nectarines within the flower. This is what you call the androecium. Androecium, this is the male part of the flower and is consists of stamens or male organs. So here, this part lies inside the corolla, and the typical stamen is made up of stalk called a filament with support supports a head called the anther. This is, allow me to show you what you call the androecium. The androecium in our figure is what you call this one is what you call androecium. Yeah, so they consist of anthers and what you call filament. So here, the typical stamen is made up of a stalk called a filament, as I said, supports a head called the anther, and anthers are usually bilobed. So A transverse section through an anthers shows that each lobe has two chambers or pollen sacs which contain the pollen grains. So this contain the male reproductive cell or of male gametes. So as we see the structure of anthers, they have formed four. So if we have make transversal section, it shows that it has two lobed chambers. So these chambers are consisting the pollen grains, and these pollen grains are called what? The productive cell, maybe male gametes. So the gynoecium is a pistil, is a female organ of the flower which contains the ovules. So this is the gynoecium as the female part, or can be called the pistil. Let me show it on that figure, and this is what we call gynoecium. This structure is showing the gynoecium. It is what we call female part of the plant, and gynoecium is, it arises from the center of the receptacles and consists of one or more carpels. So a carpel is usually made up of three parts. First, there is what you call the ovary containing the ovules, and the stylus containing the ovary to the stigma, and the stigma which receives the pollen grains. NB, after fertilization, the ovules become seed, which while the whole ovary will become the fruits. The wall of ovary develop into the pericarp of the fruits. So in the gynoecium, they have called ovary, stylo, and stigma. This is three parts that consist what we call gynoecium. The ovary developed into ovules, or the ovary contains the ovules, yes, and the stylo containing the connecting, it connects the ovary to the stigma. It's also the tube that are likely to passing through those pollen grains from the stigma to the ovary, and the stigma which receives the pollen grains, NB. So the fertilization become, if the fertilization over, those ovules likely to become what, seeds, and the whole ovary become what you call the fruit. So the whole of ovary develop into the pericarp of the fruit. Let us see evaluation of about flower. So give the function of the flower. You can give it and write to explain it. As I said, this is very simple. So name flower parts and their function. So you can explain those flower parts. I said there is calyx, corolla, and androecium and gynoecium. So let us see on the next time we will see the flower parts and their function, where we will discuss different parts of flower parts and their function, starting with stigma, ovary, stylo, ovules, receptacles, nectar, spatials, sepals, filaments, and anthers, so and so on. So allow me to stop from here on flower, and by the next time we will continue at the next lesson by explaining flower parts and their function. Thank you for watching me. I wish you so a good time, and I would like to also to make you to remember to make subscribe if you don't subscribe, and share, comment if you like my video. Thank you very much. May God bless you.